It's Professor Dave. Let's graph higher degree polynomials.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We now know how to graph a variety of functions, including parabolas, which are second degree or quadratic functions. But what about cubic functions, or quartic, or functions of higher degree still? This can get very difficult very fast, as plotting points gets rather time-consuming, and the behavior of these functions is not as predictable as lines and parabolas. But there are a few tricks we can use to get rough sketches of these functions that are fairly accurate and provide some key information about the function that is useful. Let's learn these tricks now. First, we must realize that polynomial functions with a degree of 2 or higher are smooth and continuous. They can have hills and valleys in the middle, but on either side, they tend to go towards positive or negative infinity. There are several possibilities for the end behavior of polynomial functions, which means what it does as x goes to positive or negative infinity. So let's start by learning how to figure out what the end behavior of a function will be. We can do this by using something called the leading coefficient test. We look at the leading term in a polynomial, or the term with the largest exponent, and we look at its exponent and coefficient. Depending on whether the exponent is even or odd, and whether the coefficient is positive or negative, we know what the end behavior will be. If the exponent is odd, such as with a cubic function, or one that starts with x to the fifth, x to the seventh, and so forth, if the leading coefficient is positive, the function will fall downwards to the left and rise upwards to the right. If the leading coefficient is negative, the function will rise upwards to the left and fall downwards to the right. We don't yet know what will happen in the middle, but this end behavior is a great start in terms of sketching the function. Then, if the exponent is even, such as with quadratic or quartic functions, or ones beginning with x to the sixth, x to the eighth, and so on, if the leading coefficient is positive, the function will rise upwards on both sides. If the leading coefficient is negative, the function will fall downwards on both sides. So those are the four possibilities in terms of the end behavior of higher degree polynomials. Now that we have the end behavior, the next thing to do is to find the zeros of the function. These will be the values of x that make the function equal to zero, which can be understood graphically as x-intercepts, because these are points where y equals zero. To get these, we set the function equal to zero and solve for x. This can be very tricky, but sometimes a little factoring will do it. Other times, we have to use the rational roots test in conjunction with synthetic division to find out what the zeros are. We learned this technique earlier in the series, so it would be a very good idea to check out these tutorials right now if you need to learn how to graph higher degree polynomials. To see what to do once we find the zeros, take something like x cubed plus 3x squared minus x minus 3 equals 0. If we can factor this or perform synthetic division, we can eventually express this as x plus 3 times x plus 1 times x minus 1. That means that the x-intercepts are negative 3, negative 1, and 1, since any of these values will make one term equal to 0, and thus the whole function will be equal to 0, since anything times 0 is 0. So we can plot these three points for the function right on the x-axis. Then, we can get the end behavior by noticing that the leading term has an odd exponent and a positive coefficient of 1, meaning that the function falls to the left and rises to the right. This is already enough information to sketch this function, because going left to right, it must rise up from negative infinity, cross the x-axis at this point, curve back down and cross again here, curve up and cross one more time, and then rise up towards positive infinity. It's true that we aren't getting the exact maxima and minima when using such an approach. That would require calculus. So this isn't an exact representation, but the function must indeed look roughly like this, and sometimes that's all we need to know. We must point out one other thing at this time. If a zero is listed precisely once when a function is expressed as its factors, the function will cross the x-axis at that value. But if a zero is listed twice, then the function will touch the x-axis at that value and then curve back in the direction it came from. For example, take negative x to the fourth plus 4x cubed minus 4x squared. We could do synthetic division or just recognize that we can factor out negative x squared. Then this perfect square can be expressed as x minus 2 quantity squared. We can either leave it like this or understand that this also means negative x times x minus 2 times x minus 2. This means that 0 is one of the zeros, but it is a zero twice. Positive 2 is another zero, but it is a zero twice. This makes sense because a quartic function should have four zeros, and each of these just has a multiplicity of 2. Finding the end behavior, the leading exponent is even, and the coefficient is negative, so this should fall towards negative infinity on either side. Given what we just said about zeros that occur twice, the function must rise up from the left, touch the x-axis at x equals 0, but then curve back down, curve back up to touch the x-axis again at x equals 2, and then fall back down towards negative infinity. Again, this isn't flawlessly precise, but for many purposes, this is good enough. So what we can say is that if a zero has an odd multiplicity, like 1, or sometimes 3 or greater, the function will cross the x-axis at that point. If a zero has an even multiplicity, usually 2, but sometimes more, the function will touch the x-axis at that point and then turn around. So now we have a solid strategy for graphing higher degree polynomials. Start with the leading coefficient test to find the end behavior of the function. Then find the zeros of the function by whatever method necessary, whether factoring or the rational roots test and synthetic division. Then assess the multiplicity of each zero to find out whether the function will cross or just touch the x-axis at each zero. If we want one more additional point, we can easily get the y-intercept by plugging in 0 for x, which will take just a few seconds. Then, obeying the end behavior of the function, we sketch the graph. If you're confused, watch this clip one more time. Otherwise, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.